All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, welcome everyone. My name is Sarah Carr and I'm coordinator for the Coastal Marine Ecosystem-Based Management Tools Network. This webinar is co-hosted by openchannels.org in addition to the EBM Tools Network. And we're very pleased to have here today Steven Lutz and Christian Newman from Grid Arendal. And they're going to be speaking today about making blue carbon work, building blue carbon projects in the GEF Blue Forest project. Before I turn it over to those guys, I'd like to give a heads up about the question and answer aspect of the webinar. So we definitely save a good amount of time at the end for questions. And there's two ways you can ask questions. You can type the question into the question panel of the user interface, and then I'll moderate it. I'll ask it directly to Stephen and Christian, and they will and then they can respond verbally. Or you, then the second way you can ask questions is to raise your virtual hand. There's a little hand icon in your user interface, and then I'll see that, and I can unmute you. This option only works if we can hear you, so you need to have a working microphone if you're using the computer audio, or have typed in your PIN number if you're using your telephone audio. And we'll save the verbal questions till the end, but if you have any questions you just want to type in, feel free to do that at any point during the webinar. Substantive questions will hold for the Q&A period, but if there's any clarifying questions, I might be able to ask Stephen and Christian during the webinar. Okay, and I'll turn it over now. Thank you, guys.
Oh, thank you very much. Whoops. Thank you very much, Sarah, and hello and welcome everybody to our Making Blue Carbon Work webinar. Can I just, I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with this. Do you guys see my PowerPoint or do you see my control panel in front of my PowerPoint?
We don't see your control panel at
you
all.
You don't see my control panel at all. Okay, yeah, so I need to get rid of it here. Okay, thanks. Again, thank you, Sarah, and thanks everybody for coming. My name is Christian Neumann. I will give the first half of the presentation, and then the other half will come from Stephen Lutz. We both work for Grid Arendal, and as you can see in the top right of your screen there, we are a center collaborating with UNEP, so we're closely affiliated with them. We work in the south of Norway. That's where we Grid Arendal is. Where Arendal is. It's a place in the south of Norway. Usually it's beautiful. In November time, it's pretty shabby, actually. Before we go into the substance and the steps of making a blue carbon project happen and the elements that that we suggest could be interesting for such a project, I just wanted to bring to your attention the blue carbon portal that we host as Grid Arendal together with UNEP. It's a portal that is an information portal, so we have a resource library on there, we have news, we have project sites on there, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really a portal for the community, and it's also run by the community. So if you have any material that you want to share, any information about your work or your projects or publications or news items or whatever, just let us know and we'll help you get it out there. You see one of the publications that Grid Arendal has done on blue carbon. This is the one that actually coined the term, and that was published in 2009. So that's one in our resource library. And the one that we are going to focus on today in this webinar is what you see here on the right, is the introductory guide to building blue carbon projects. And what this publication does, it pulled together the experience of all the organizations that you see at the bottom. And there, the experience that they have in blue carbon projects or blue carbon related activities. And it's part, or it's an output of the Abu Dhabi Blue Carbon Demonstration Project that Grid Arendal led together with the Abu Dhabi Global Environment Data Initiative. The information that we gathered in that demonstration project, and I'll talk about the project a little later, also went into this as well as the development of the GEF Blue Forest project, which Stephen will talk about a little later. just to get everybody on the same page, I thought I would give a very, very brief introduction on what blue carbon is, and sort of the definition that you'll see here is obviously only one definition. This one is rather focused, if I may say so. But for the sake of this publication, we said it's a recent concept that recognizes the role that some coastal ecosystems play in naturally storing greenhouse gases, thereby helping to mitigate climate change. So this gives us a little bit of focus in terms of which ecosystems we're talking about. So the focus ecosystems for blue carbon are often mangroves, salt marshes, and seagrass. But there's others, and I'll mention a few later again. When we talk about greenhouse gases, we obviously focus on carbon and mitigation of climate change. The sequestration and storing of carbon from the atmosphere is the focus ecosystem service that we're looking at for blue carbon, but there's other ecosystem services that these ecosystems provide. Here's another illustration of what blue carbon ecosystems do. So firstly, and that's what you see in the top with the big circles, they sequester carbon, and you see the rates by which they do that. This is between what the black dots are, the minimum values that were found in a global study by the Duke University in 2011, and the circles are the maximum values that they've found across the range of global habitats that they looked at. And what's really important about blue carbon habitats is that they sequester, they store in their biomass. That's what you see in the second in the squares. And then what makes them special is that they store carbon in the soil. And that's actually, as you can see here, is the greater share of the carbon. So that's really what's important about blue carbon ecosystems, and it's also what makes them so valuable from a carbon storage perspective. That's where you get those values that can be greater than what you find in tropical forests, for example. They store carbon in what's called carbon horizons in the soil. They can go down to a few dozen meters. So obviously they do that when they're healthy. When they're healthy, they continue to sequester, and they continue to store and cap the carbon that is buried. And when they're degraded, not only do they lose the ability to sequester carbon, they also release carbon into the atmosphere. And that is obviously a problem in times of rising, in times of climate change. Like I said before, carbon sequestration and storage is the focus ecosystem service for blue carbon, but blue carbon ecosystems provide other services, and this is obviously an incomplete list, but mangroves in particular, also seagrass, they service fish habitat as nursery grounds, they have a high tourism value, they provide habitat for other biodiversity. Both mangroves and seagrasses are important in terms of water purification, which is again important for coral reefs, and they also have a role in protecting from extreme weather events. They had a role in protecting coastal communities against the impacts of the tsunami in 2004, against hurricanes, etc. So they have a clear value and benefit for coastal communities, their livelihoods, their food security, and so forth. These ecosystem services can obviously be valued in economic terms, and that's something that we've seen growing as a science probably over the last decade or a little more. And when we look here, here's a list of ecosystem service values that has been put together by de Groot and colleagues in 2012. And what you see here is that among the ecosystems that they assessed, the coastal wetlands, which group together the blue carbon ecosystems we're talking about, they rank very, very high, second to coral reefs, but provide values a lot more valuable than tropical forests, for example, rivers and lakes, etc., which you see further to the right. So this was really a very brief introduction, and if there's any questions to that, I guess maybe we'll clarify them after the presentation, either between this and Stephen's presentation or at the very end. So from here, I'd like to look into building blue carbon projects and what the phases and potential elements of that are. You can break it down into sort of four phases of blue carbon projects, the first phase being a scoping exercise, the second being planning of your projects and processes, and then going to demonstration and an actual implementation. So when we look at scoping studies, is what we call a preparatory step towards projects, where in the first you raise awareness among your stakeholders or the ministries that you want to talk with. You develop a common understanding of what blue carbon is, what role it can have for management. You build the interest. What's also important is to create what we call here, create settings for sectors and stakeholders to come together. As blue carbon usually touches the mandates or roles of a range of ministries of organizations that that may not be used to talking. So when we talk about carbon reporting, for example, that may sit with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. When it comes to the management of cutting carbon, that may be with agriculture. Fisheries is obviously important. Tourism development could be important, et cetera, et cetera. So bringing these people together is actually a valuable step on its own, but also a prerequisite to a successful blue carbon project. Identifying the target geographic areas for actual activities and implementations, you can look at the most valuable areas for blue carbon habitats or ecosystems. If you have that information available, you could look at low-hanging fruits of an ongoing MPA establishment process that you want to support by blue carbon, for example. And then taking stock of existing management practices and scientific capacity builds the baseline for you, so you know what kind of activities are really needed in a given situation, what is most useful to the stakeholders you have. Then clearly illustrating the need and the scope of a potential project will sort of help you defining together with your stakeholders what it is that you want to do. And from there you go to planning the process. There's no rocket science in here. What's important is to identify measurable objectives and setting clear goals, because blue carbon sometimes comes with the notion of carbon credits, of additional funding, and it's certainly a role that blue carbon can play. And Stephen is going to talk about a project that has actually generated funds from blue carbon, from mangrove conservation, but it's important to manage the expectations to that. And then choosing the scientific methodologies for blue carbon assessment, just expand on that a little bit, because this really is dependent on the information that you have available, on the science that's available, on the maps of ecosystems that are available, also on the scientific capacity that you have in the country that you're working in. And as you all know, science is costly, particularly in the marine environment, particularly in remote areas. So you need to be sure that your scientific methodologies match the funds and the expectations that are there. Before Stephen talks about applying blue carbon and implementing it, I was going to give one example for a blue carbon demonstration project, the one that we did in Abu Dhabi. And this is in no way... the right way of doing it. It has some of the elements that we think are relevant for blue carbon projects, and it's really only a suggestion and illustration of what we think can be done. So when you think of blue carbon or any coastal ecosystems, you probably don't think of Abu Dhabi, as Abu Dhabi is really what it looks like here on this satellite image. It's largely desert, but when you get to the coast, it has actually a pretty surprising, or at least to me, it was pretty surprising to see the range of ecosystems that are there. And what you see here in green are seagrass beds, which are very extensive in the Emirate. Just a quick look at the environmental conditions in the emirate. It's pretty hot. Air temperatures can go up to 50 degrees, and the water temperatures are high as well. So that's not ideal for any mangrove, for example. It's pretty dry as well, and salinity is about double the value that you see in a quote unquote normal ocean, which generally has about 30-35 PSU. So we see one single species of mangroves there, that's Avicenna. I'll have that in the next slide. They have quite dense and pristine natural mangrove stands. These don't grow very high. Probably the highest would be around 3 to 4 meters, which is not high in the global comparison. But locally, it's very important. And there's a large amount of mangrove plantation going on. Technically, this is very well done. They have survival rates of mangroves over 95%, which is really impressive. And they're planting them by the millions. So, and then in addition to mangroves, you have salt marshes, seagrass beds. And like I said, they're very extensive in the emirate. It's said to be the second largest seagrass bed in the world after Australia. So these are sort of the usuals. Like I said before, when we talk about blue carbon ecosystems, salt marshes, seagrass, and mangroves are the common ones. We looked at two further ecosystems because we really wanted to present or get a really comprehensive picture of blue carbon in the emirate. So we looked at algal mats as well that are usually associated with salt marsh and that we found to be pretty high in carbon storage, and also at a very unique ecosystem for that area called Sapka, which is a dry, it's usually dry and gets inundated only in few sort of extreme weather events. When you have high tides and storms that would then inundate plains, you would then have photosynthesis and then the algae die out again. So those are the ecosystems, those are the five ecosystems that we looked at in Abu Dhabi. It has an astonishing biodiversity, that place. So you see dugongs, you see turtles, you see dolphins. There are no coral reefs, but there are corals, so there are the fish that are associated with it, etc., etc. So just to give you a bit of background on that particular project. What we did there is, well, these are the elements of the project, the components, the work packages, however you want to call it. And like I said, it's what we did in Abu Dhabi, and it's in no way a prescriptor for anything, but you know, these are the elements that we thought we could we would like to present, and that we also explain in a little more detail in the introductory guide that I showed in the beginning, and the interplay. So what you see here are the four different ecosystem carbon assessments that we've done: mangrove, seagrass, salt marsh, and algal mats and coastal sapka. And together with a map of those ecosystems, there was a separate work package, we were able to make a map of the carbon. So once we understood the extent area of those ecosystems and how much carbon they contain per unit area, we know how much carbon we have in the emirate. And we mapped that. And then on top of that, we did an ecosystem services assessment. And so when you put together the ecosystem map and the carbon map and the other ecosystem services that these ecosystems provide, you can derive values both not only in the economic sense, but also in the social and particularly the cultural sense, which we found to be particularly important in the emirate. The cultural value of mangroves is very high. You find mangroves around the palaces, etc., and also the most pristine ones. And then from there, we look at the financial feasibility with the focus on carbon credits, looking at how much money could be generated from carbon credits if they were sold in the market, and what were the opportunity costs of developing, you know, a residential area or something in where you have the blue carbon ecosystems. We looked at policy feasibility, looking at what are potential avenues for incorporating this blue carbon information into management and regulation. And from all these components, we came to options or recommendations for blue carbon action. So I'd like to go in a little more detail on these different work packages. Just real quick, like I said, the carbon assessment, it assessed plant cover, above ground biomass, as well as the important soil carbon stocks. We also identified additional data to understand the regime that is governing the storing of carbon, and so largely on the soil chemistry. And we also took high-resolution location and elevation data that was to support those that analysis. I was going to give you a few names, if you know, these may be familiar to some or not, or if you're interested in a project like this, I can highly recommend everyone we've worked with. So the carbon assessment was led by Steve Crooks. The mangrove team was led by the Oregon State University, Boone Kaufman. Smithsonian Environmental Research Center did the salt marshes, and Florida International University did the seagrass. So they led those research teams. And then secondly, we had the geographic assessment that was undertaken by UNEP WCMC out of Cambridge. And what they initially did is they mapped based on the information that was provided to them, which was largely satellite imagery. So they interpreted the satellite imagery and went to a range of experts, particularly in the Environment Agency, and consulted with them on the interpretation of it. They also did a fair amount of ground truthing to understand the accuracy, and then they mapped it. They developed a mapping tool that is really useful, one as a library for those data, but it also allows people to, you know, draw a polygon on a map and understand how much carbon you would find in that piece of land, and that you would lose if you're gonna develop it. It also allows for refinement of the data, so it links to a ground truthing app that you can put on your iPad, et cetera, et cetera. Tim Wilkinson of WCMC is going to present that on December 16th, 1 hour later than we're presenting here today, and I can highly recommend that. It's really interesting. It's really cool. So looking at the ecosystem services assessment, that was done by Forest Trends. And what that the focus of this work was really stakeholder consultations to understand how people use the ecosystems from a tourism perspective, from a fisheries perspective, from an urban planning perspective, et cetera, et cetera. It was also a way of generating an understanding with those stakeholders, and thirdly, to get data from them. So it's really a very important exercise in any blue carbon project, I would say. They also did a rapid assessment of ecosystem condition, focusing on seagrass, to understand better how the quality of an ecosystem affects the provision of ecosystem services. And then mapped high productivity sites, you know, both from a carbon perspective and other ecosystem services perspective, and high asset areas, which are important when you look at coastline stabilization, for example. And out of that derived a map of at least an initial map of priority areas for further study. I lumped together here the policy and finance assessments, although they were separate and undertaken by different people, by UNEP and Forest Trends respectively, because they were often done together. The stakeholder consultations were done with a wide range of authorities and organizations again, which proved to be really useful to understand what the most feasible options are for integrating blue carbon into management, what the things are that the policymakers or the planners or regulators could work with or found promising. So So this is, again, it's the same sketch that I showed before, just for you to look at it again and see how this all plays together. Again, whether you want to look at the full range of ecosystems or want to focus on one, or if ecosystems are more important, ecosystem services beyond carbon are more important or less, it's up to whoever's designing the project. But what I wanted to emphasize is that this all looks at improving our understanding of both the ecosystems and sort of the scenario for blue carbon. But what we also suggest should receive at least some focus is, one is raising awareness, and that means making sure that, one, you have a strong stakeholder engagement, you really talk with a lot of people, and you have some targeted communication budget available that will support all these activities and the later uptake in policy making. Another aspect that was really important was the building capacity. So we invited both scientists from the Emirate as well as partners from Indonesia and Madagascar to share their experiences with the field teams that we had and vice versa. And we also did in-house trainings on the theories that are behind everything, and also did field excursions with journalists and with the interested public and so forth. And then lastly, we support the management, so we support the uptake of this information into management through specific tools such as the carbon visualization tool that I mentioned before that WCMC did and that they will present on the 16th. I'll end this demonstration part by saying that although it was a 1.5 year project only, it really had significant results. This is not to brag about how good we are, but to show that blue carbon projects really can work, and there's a great interest in the policy making sphere. So it's been taken up in a number of policy making processes in the Emirate, into planning processes such as marine spatial planning, urban planning, etc. And also the interest was in the United Arab Emirates in the country was big, so it's becoming replicated in other Emirates. And lastly, obviously, it's also provided important lessons on the science side. So this was a brief explanation on these three stages, the scoping, the planning, and the demonstration phase of blue carbon. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Stephen, who's going to give the second part of this webinar. Thanks, everyone.
Okay, thank you, Christian. And I've switched the Stephen's now presenter, so.
Yes, I'm here. Very good. Thank you very much, Christian. And I would just like to say that the components that we looked at and explored through Abu Dhabi also contributed to the components that we've listed in the Building Blue Carbon Projects report. But not just that, we also, Gerd Arendal also managed putting together the GEF Blue Forest project. And so through discussions with our partners on this project, we were able to include that learning into this Building Blue Forest project guide as well. Thank you. So I'm talking about now is the what I'm talking about now is the GEF Blue Forest project, and this is a global initiative funded by the Global Environment Facility to basically take blue carbon and ecosystem services to sort of the next level. And the project is called Blue Forests, and it recognizes both carbon and the range of ecosystem services for mangroves, seagrass, and salt marsh, although the demonstrations of the project are mostly focused on mangroves. The full title of this project is the Standardized Methodologies for Carbon Accounting and Ecosystem Services Valuation of Blue Forests, and there will be a test on that at the end. Okay. So it's a $4.5 million of GEF funds going into this and $23 million of co-finance from the partners, mostly in kind, but some of it in cash, which represents sort of the baseline for blue carbon in the valuation of ecosystem services for blue carbon or blue forests ecosystems, which are the mangroves, seagrasses, and salt marshes. The project was endorsed by the CEO of the GEF in March 2014. It's currently in its implementation phase, and we just had our project inception workshop and first project steering committee meeting in Abu Dhabi just earlier this month. And the official start date will be January 2015. The project will run for 4 years. The implementation agency is UNEP, and the executing agency is Grid Arendal.
Okay, so Stephen, could you speak up a little bit more?
Sorry.
Or move the mic closer if you can. Yeah.
The mic is closer now. Okay, so as you can see here, it's a global project with quite a few partners. And I've listed all the partners over to the right and their logos down below because I don't have time to go through them all. But we have a lot of significant blue carbon interests involved on the project. In blue, you can see where the small-scale interventions are. Now, the project that we completed in Abu Dhabi counts as one of our featured small-scale interventions. And a small-scale intervention, for those that don't know, that's sort of GEF language for a demonstration project, just to confuse you. Okay. So we also have demonstrations in Ecuador, Mozambique, Madagascar, Indonesia, and replication and upscaling activities, which are sort of mini pilots in Kenya and in Central America. Okay. And one of the co-finance partners that we have is the Kenyan Marine Fisheries Research Institute. And what they've brought to the table through co-finance is a project called Mikoko Pamoja, which is a very small-scale project that was started a number of years ago looking at certification for mangrove carbon, for payment for ecosystem services, in this case for mangrove carbon, in coastal Kenya, in Gezi Bay. And a little bit about the history. So back in the 1970s, there was coastal degradation primarily through commercial logging and land conversion, and this resulted in ecosystem services being decreased for the local community. Okay. And in 2010, just about, I think about 6 months or a year after the Blue Carbon Report was introduced in 2009, their project idea note was approved for this project. The Kenya Marine Fisheries Research Institute worked with a number of partners, including universities in the UK. The project was verified in 2013, and the government issued a forest management agreement to the Pazi Gate community in 2013. Now, this is a vital step for blue carbon projects because it means that the community can actually claim the revenue that comes in from this project. Otherwise, it would be a legal ground. It would be a typical legal ground. And in March of this year or earlier, I think payments were realized for the first time. So what does that look like? Well, as I said, it was a small-scale project, so it's only about 107 hectares, so a very tiny plot of land, but that generates about $15,000 annually to the Gezi Bay community. And what we have here is the negotiated financial flow for the disbursement of the funds that come in from the mangrove carbon. And as you'll see down here on your lower right-hand side, can you see my little pointer here?
Yes, we can.
Okay, yep. So down here, you can see that at least a third of the revenue that comes in supports the monitoring of existing stands of mangroves and the planting of new or the restoration of mangroves. Okay, so what we have here is a project with funds coming from the mangrove carbon that is supporting the maintenance and the management of the existing and replanting of mangroves there. And that's basically what we want to see from the Blue Carbon Project. And this is, I would say, probably the world's first functioning Blue Carbon Project. And what are the impacts so far? So since payments have been realized this year, it's created jobs. It's supported livelihood. There's also an ecotourism venture that's connected to the site, and it's supported education of the community and improved water and sanitation for the community, and mangrove reforestation. And so what's the outcome or what can we do next with Mikoko Pomoja? Well, it's really exciting because actually through the GEF Blue Forest Project, we're going to be taking this case study and replicating it elsewhere in Kenya. And the potential is that this project could be replicated throughout Kenya and maybe throughout the region. And so we're gonna see how that goes. As I mentioned with the Blue Forest Project, the start date for this is for all of our partners is in 2015 in January. So we're going to be monitoring this, evaluating it, and measuring the impact for the next 4 years. I think the replication and upskilling activity for our activities in Kenya is over 2 years. So you don't have to wait too long. Okay, here's another demonstration site of the GEF Blue Forest Project. And this is through Conservation International Ecuador. It's in the Gulf of Guayaquil, and it looks at the valuation of mangrove ecosystem services and mangrove concessions. These are agreements with local communities, and then advances carbon and ecosystem services mangrove policy with the national government. All of these projects will be uploaded, or information on these projects will be uploaded to our website we're just putting together. And at the end of my presentation, I have a link on that. I'm just giving you a brief overview of what the GEF Blue Forest Project is about. And here's a little bit about our Madagascar small-scale intervention with two location sites in Madagascar. And the key activities of this intervention or demonstration site are your mangrove carbon sequestration assessment, your mangroves under red plus, mangrove mapping and change analysis, ecosystem services assessment, financial valuation, and the red plus development. So the idea here is to have mangroves included under the UN program of reducing emissions through deforestation and degradation, which has which will enable Blue Ventures or other parties in Madagascar to claim mangrove carbon credits for the work that they're doing. So we have the Indonesian small-scale intervention, which is put together by the Ministry of Marine Affairs and Fisheries there. And it looks at similar types of activities. And as you can see, there's quite a bit of overlap between the activities, between each of these interventions. But they're not exactly the same. And then for Mozambique, that's put together by World Wildlife Fund Mozambique. And they're also looking at Red Plus development, and a large focus on ecosystem services assessment. That's related to mangroves. So what are the other parts of the GEF Blue Forest Project? Well, actually, we have a whole component of the GEF Blue Forest Project that gives project-level support through three advisory panels. One advisory panel is on carbon science. The other advisory panel is on ecosystem services. And the third advisory panel is on Blue Forest policy. And the idea behind these is to make sure that these interventions or demonstrations that I've just discussed get the best and latest scientific and policy advice to help their implementation. Okay? And additionally, these values will be upscaled to the international community through another component. It looks at the end of this project in 4 years, what do we do? Well, we have lessons learned from all of these interventions, and the idea is to go back to international policy and see if we can get further support for Blue Forests. We also have targeted research in component three, looking at to address key knowledge gaps with regard to Blue Forest ecosystems. So for example, since many of the partners wanted to focus on mangrove ecosystems, then we have here in this section a focus on seagrass ecosystems. We also have a focus on understanding the potential societal effects of advancing a blue forests or blue carbon projects. And then some targeted research on salt marshes as well. And finally, a final component, as I mentioned, is the international policy engagement and uptake. And so a lot of the projects that we're looking at have the goal of carbon finance, which is basically to generate carbon finance, like, for example, Mikoko Pomoja, and to use the revenue to support the project goals. Oops, sorry, let me go back one. Okay, but the idea behind this slide, which comes from the Building Blue Carbon Projects guide, is that there's many pathways and potential actions to realize your goals. So it may be through carbon finance, it may be through incorporating the value of blue carbon or blue forest to meet or complement national policy goals or international commitments, or it may be through conservation agreements with local communities or other mechanisms that you can use the value of blue carbon to support your project goals. Okay. And as we say in Norway, tusen takk. And my name is Stephen Lutz with my colleague Christian Newman, and I have the link to the Building Blue Carbon Projects report, the Blue Forest Project, and the Blue Carbon Portal here. And I would just like to say to everybody that through the portal, we'd like to share experiences and projects and learning with regard to blue carbon. So if you have any projects that you'd like to see highlighted on our portal, could you please send them to us? Or if you have any sort of lessons learned or other sorts of information, we'd love to share that with the community. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. So this is great. So we have a bunch of questions, some on the section that Christian was presenting on and some from Stephen. So we'll go ahead and get started. Let's see. The first question to roll in, an always important one, what was the budget for the assessment for the Abu Dhabi project?
Christian, you there?
I am here.
it's a
tough one. I'm not even sure I can disclose it. Just thinking if we broke it down. Well, it was certainly in the six digits. Let's put it that way. It was because it was so comprehensive and it had fields. Components in it, and we had boats and rather big teams of experts, etc. It was, I think, on the luxury side.
Yes, so it runs about a few $100,000, but
yeah.
I think that you should remember that this was done in a rapid manner. The GEF Blue Forest project is 4 years, and the Abu Dhabi project was actually scheduled for a year. It went on a little bit longer, but it was done under sort of a very high speed and high pressure. So that type of a project does increase costs.
Okay, thank you. All right. Let's see. And this one also came in during the Abu Dhabi section. How are the non-economic benefits of the ecosystems included in the assessment at the policy implementation level? Are the policymakers willing to take cultural values into account in the Emirates?
It was really interesting. Towards the end of the project, that we found that those are probably the more relevant values, at least in that specific cultural setting, because Abu Dhabi is obviously a very rich place, and when we presented the economic figures that we had calculated for the services that they provided, and I think we came to $2 billion in value, over 20 years. People were like, "Uh-huh, 2 billion, really? Is that it?" So, in the terms of money that is being made in Abu Dhabi, that isn't a lot. But like I said before, the cultural value of protecting mangroves, particularly around palaces, for example, or the social value of planting mangroves or donating mangroves effectively, when you have the means to do that, was far greater than any economic, motivation for it, or financial.
Okay, that's a great perspective to hear. So, good question. Thank you, Christian. Let's see, what next? And then one that was also definitely came in during the Abu Dhabi section was, can you elaborate on successes achieved and biggest problems, constraints?
The successes achieved were certainly in raising the awareness, like I presented in that slide, in raising awareness of blue carbon and the value, and directly feeding into policy development or planning processes. We were lucky in that there is a new, I think, 30-year development plan that was being put together at the time of the project, so we were able to feed into that, which was partly, obviously, coincidence and partly a result of the strong stakeholder engagement component that we had in the work. So that was probably, those policy impacts were probably the biggest successes for us. The challenge was certainly the timing. Like Stephen was saying, it was designed for 12 months and we went a little bit over, but that made it a challenge also in terms of impact, because, you know, usually that's not when, you know, that you don't see impacts of your project so quickly. Other challenges were that's part of the rapid nature of this project, was the stakeholder engagement, sort of laying the foundation for getting access to many of the people, understanding where they were coming from, et cetera, et cetera. So sometimes you want to meet certain people a number of times, so you build at least a bit of a relationship and so forth. When it comes to science or the field sampling, we had to do a bit of sort of on-the-spot development of CORAs, etc. So the science teams came in early, and there was a fair degree of welding, etc., that needed to be done in prep of the field surveys. But I don't think that was a particular challenge for them. I think, yeah. Did that answer the question?
Yes. Yeah. Definitely. Great.
More specific. Yeah.
Okay, we're definitely not going to be able to get to all the questions, but I will just want to let everyone know that all the questions will be provided to the speakers, and if their contact information is up there in case you have a specific question you want to get to them with. Okay, I also wanted to let everyone know, if you're interested in a copy of the recording, contact me at sarah_carr@natureserve.org, and I can send you the copy of the recording. Okay. Another question that can go to either or both. How do you go about initiating blue carbon projects in areas where carbon-related scientific data is missing? It seems to me that this is the biggest challenge, if no scientific data is available at a local scale.
Stephen, that's exactly what you faced in the scoping of the Arabian Peninsula. So,
So we did a feasibility assessment for blue carbon in the Arabian Peninsula, looking at where data was, where data was lacking. And I'd say Abu Dhabi had more data than others, but, you know, they didn't really have the carbon data that didn't exist. So for this type of blue carbon project, we had to start from scratch. And the idea globally for blue carbon is you've got to put more points on the map. You want to have more carbon assessments, you would have more seagrass assessments, and you're going to start from scratch. So what we did is we brought in an international team of experts to start from scratch and to work with locals, with local scientists and management authorities to develop the baseline, and that's what we've developed through our project. Now in other regions you already have local scientists that you can work with and enhance and build upon. So if I was going to do this someplace else, I definitely would scour, like we did in Abu Dhabi, to see where the local experts were to begin with. They've done something like carbon assessments, carbon health assessments, carbon biomass assessments, that sort of stuff.
Okay, great, thank you.
Can I add one thought?
Yes, please.
Maybe it's in some areas, or you know, under, you know, when you don't have those funds available, you might not be able to go into the level of detail as we went there. But it also depends on the confidence that you need on your data, and that's dependent on your purpose. So if you want to raise awareness on the value of those ecosystems for climate change mitigation, it may be enough to have a rough estimate based on biomass, based on area, based on satellite images. It's going to be relatively, you know, rough, but still it's good enough to raise awareness. On the other end of the spectrum, if you want to sell carbon credits, then you really need to know how much is in there, and you need to prove it, and you need to provide the science. So the point I'm trying to make is you don't need the exact data, depending on what it is that you want to do with it.
Okay, and you're starting to hit on some points that a lot of people ask about. So let's see, some other sort of somewhat related questions. Were you able, this is for Christiane specifically, were you able to compare carbon estimates based on UNEP mapping of habitats versus globally available maps? The reason I ask is because most projects don't have the budget for remote sensing. I wonder if the results would be significantly different.
Can you, I'm not sure I got the question right. Was I able to compare, were we able to compare sequestration or storage rates or pools?
Well, it's a carbon estimates based on the UNEP mapping of habitats. So probably, let's come to sequestration rates.
What we obviously did was compare them to values that have been found in other areas of the world. And it won't be a surprise to see that that the rates for Abu Dhabi were at the lower end of what we see in other places, particularly when it comes to the mangroves. I was hoping that I could put up a slide, but I can't find it as we talk. But yeah, we did compare it, and it was on the oh, there it is. If you wanna. Can I share my screen again?
I'll make you presenter again. Okay.
So, show my screen. So here you'll have a bit of a comparison of total biomass and soil, and you'll have a number of sites that were studied in, so Bangladesh, Borneo is obviously very high, et cetera, et cetera. And then you see the grand average here, and you see where Abu Dhabi ranks. In terms of total biomass, it isn't actually so great, but when you look at the soil, well, at least, you know, in proportion to the others, it's a little bit more significant. So on the global scale, there's others that are more significant. On a regional scale, it's really important. Sorry.
Okay.
Where are we?
All right, thank you.
Here.
All right, another question. Oh, yeah, okay. This one's for Stephen. Are there any thoughts on incorporating the findings from the small-scale sites into large marine ecosystems when applicable, so scaling up GEF initiatives?
Yes, I would say that there is, but we're going to get into that in the later stages of the project. But basically, that's one of our mandates, is to make sure that this project is upscaled where necessary. I would say that the two focal areas for what we're doing through the Blue Forest project is the implementation of these demonstrations, and then the second focal area is to share experiences. So that is a major component of what we're going to be doing, and hopefully we'll have all that sort of stuff up on the public page of the GEF Blue Forest project website, but also it will be shared with the Blue Carbon portal as well.
Okay, great. Thank you. Another interesting question. Are there any comparative studies which show the impact of blue carbon versus other carbon capture and storage options in terms of efficacy, finances, and other benefits?
I would say that we could look into that question, but I don't know if that really exists yet, except in a more hypothetical way, because we only have one really functioning blue carbon project yet, and that is Mikoko Pomoja. Well, then again, Abu Dhabi is realizing the values of blue carbon to improve ecosystem management. So I'd say we have maybe two examples, but one is a very large scale project and one is a tiny project. So I would just say we'd have to wait and see for that.
I have no answer in terms of comparative analysis. I have not come across any. I think it's important to mention in this context that while these ecosystems sequester and store carbon, and that has a value, they do a lot of other things too, and that's in some cases can be a lot more valuable. So it's the comparison. You need to be very careful about what you compare.
Okay, good point. And then also another question, are there any risks to marine ecosystems by storing and sequestering more carbon in blue carbon habitats by planting seagrasses, et cetera, and restoring habitats?
Well, if you're restoring a natural ecosystem, I wouldn't say that there's any risk. If you're bulldozing one ecosystem to plant another one, then I'd say you are having a risk. But I don't think we're doing that in any of our projects. Christian?
Yeah. It's a funny question. It's an interesting question. Yeah, that's the only thing that I can think of. If you go in there and say, look, I want to plant mangroves here, and I'm going to destroy another ecosystem for it, say salt marshes, because they don't look as interesting. You might lose a lot of carbon, you might lose a lot of biodiversity by doing that. So that would be a risk. That's the only thing I can think of, but if whoever has that question has another idea, I'd be interested to hear it.
Okay. No, well, nothing's come in, but thank you. No, it's a very interesting question. Let's see, and there's a question that's sort of like looking at the revenue from the carbon credits versus the project costs. So I guess this is for Stephen specifically. Was the revenue from the carbon credits also able to pay for the costs associated with project registration and validation?
No. So that's not where we are with Micocopamoja. So the registration and the exploration costs were quite significant in comparison to the revenue received. But one has to remember that when you start anything new and innovative, you're going to have higher costs starting out than when you have further successes through other projects. So it's perfectly accepted and expected that you'd have high startup costs, especially for the first few blue carbon projects.
Okay, yes, absolutely. And Christian, did you have anything to add?
I remember we had a conversation around that, and I remember that Linwood Pendleton, he's a professor in economics, he's made a sort of back-of-the-envelope calculation, and I think we came up with a return on investment from a Micocopamoja in 15 years, if I'm not mistaken. And this is not a scientific analysis. It's really we chatted about it. But that's not so bad, 15 years. And
yeah,
that looked
right,
at, all the science that went in there and the project management, et cetera, and how much money was generated per year and so forth. And I think that's what we came out at, 15 years.
Okay. Well, back of the analyst is the best we've got right now. So good. sounds like I'm glad it's been thought about. Let's see. We have two more sort of things I wanted to touch on, some more comments. Blue carbon projects, especially mangroves, may help in reducing the disaster from tsunamis and coastal flooding. And the comment was, disaster risk reduction programs may be good collaborating partners. Have you guys had any experience in this realm?
Christian, were any of the stakeholders?
I don't think we've. It's a point that obviously it comes up as one of the ecosystem services. And I think there's been some significant study that suggests that yes, they do have a value in moderating extreme events, particularly looking at the tsunami and the but we have never worked with disaster risk reduction projects. I think it would be a very interesting overlap, and I think it's a great comment, but we have no experience on it, and I'm not sure anyone does.
Yeah. I'd have to reach out to our Indonesian partners and see if that's on their list or in their mandate as well. So I think that's a very interesting question. Thank you.
Okay. And then just one other quick one, because I know you guys, it's late for you in Norway. Do you know of any studies that have been conducted on how to use the economic value of blue carbon, perhaps via carbon markets, to incentivize management and or restoration efforts in coastal wetlands?
There's a very good report that has been put out by Duke University called, is it called Green Investments in Blue Carbon, Stephen?
Green Payments for Blue Carbon, that's a really
Green Payments for Blue Carbon, yeah. That does a pretty thorough analysis also of the opportunities, of the costs, etc. So it's a global study, but it's really good.
And the other one I'd like to suggest is Resources for the Future has put out a report called Blue Carbon, Global Options for Reducing Emissions from Degradation and Development of Coastal Ecosystems. And that's actually a pretty good one, a pretty good source for the subject matter.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you, guys. And actually, some really good questions that came at the end, which I'm sorry we're not able to get to, concerning sea level rise and blue carbon projects and policy tools. So, yeah, some good stuff. So anyway, thank you guys so much. We really appreciate you coming and talking, and we're glad this is a series, and we're going to get some more Blue Carbon webinars. And I highly encourage people to get in touch with you guys with specific questions. But again, thank you so much.
Yeah.
And there are lots of people sending in thanks through the email and the system, so we're very glad you guys were able to do this today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for hosting, and thanks everyone for listening. And if you have any more questions or comments, feel free to shoot us an email.
Tusen takk from Norway.
Take care. Okay. Bye bye, everyone.
Bye.
Right. Thanks, everyone. Have a great rest of your day.